sing that one time with him.
Introduce their new pastor to the church and the congregation. We
We would like to introduce to you Pastor Jeremiah Stepick. The congregation looked around. They were clapping. They were had joy. There was great anticipation. And all of a sudden, as they were waiting for their new pastor to arrive, the homeless man began to make his way to the front. People didn't know what to think. They didn't understand what was happening. Surely this man who I just had looked at with disdain and disgust is not the pastor who will lead us. This 10,000-member church, this church with great esteem and great honor and great reputation, the congregation was confused. As he walked down the aisle, all the excitement and all the clapping ceased, and everyone started looking at him. He walked up to the altar. He took the microphone. He paused for a moment, and then he said, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come. You who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the day of the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me, and I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothing and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' The king will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters, you did for me.'" After he recited this, he looked towards the congregation and told them all that he had experienced that morning. The dirty looks, people moving away, the people refusing to assist. And then he asked the question. He said, "Today I see a gathering of people. I don't see the church of Jesus Christ. The world has enough people, but not enough disciples. When will you decide to become a disciple?" It was at that moment that this new pastor dismissed the church for that morning. He didn't say any other sermon. They didn't sing any other songs. He didn't say any other prayers. He let them know that we are called to be disciples. We are called to respond to the Christ that is in our midst. We are called to be more and greater than we've ever thought we could be. For you see, my brothers and sisters, when we recognize that we are called to something greater than ourselves. See, we live in a time where it's always about me, about what is happening with me, what is happening with my family. But when we recognize that we are called to this greater body of Christ, and this body of Christ is calling us to reach out to those that are in the midst, my brothers and sisters, then we will truly understand what is said by saying that we have truly met and interacted and been with God. Amen. For you see, when you are truly in the midst and you truly understand who you are in the presence of, it changes how we view the outward situation. Amen. See, it's difficult to say I'm a Christian, but nothing ever changes in our personal lives nor our attitudes towards others. That is a difficult thing to make, a difficult argument to hold. Yes, you can say I believe on Christ. Yes, you can say I'm going to heaven. And yes, all those things are true. But the reality says, do we want the best that God has for us now? In the opportunities that he's given us right now? Or do we simply wait for a far off heaven in a far off place till we realize all that God has for us in this time? The day God visited you. Amen. Well, the text opens up, friends, and we see a situation. We see how fast a situation of triumph, a feeling of joy, a moment of esteem, a moment of remembrance, we can see how quickly that will transform into the shedding of tears. See, ask yourself the same question, and you know that's the truth. Maybe every now and again you can say, "I've been feeling real good. I've been walking around and I feel great." You looked in the mirror before you left and you said, "My hair looks good today. My mustache is shaped just right. My tie is just right. My shoes are shined just the right way." And all it takes is one thing, one snide remark from someone that you weren't in the feeling like hearing that day, or one situation of being in traffic, or a car accident, or a bad report from the doctor. All it takes is one thing, and all of a sudden your whole mood has changed in a heartbeat.
Amen.
See, sometimes we expect of Jesus as a man to not have some of the feelings that we as men and women have ourselves. But the reality says that the Jesus that we serve has to be fully man and fully God. Otherwise, if he is not fully man and fully God, the sacrifice would not have been enough. But the scripture tells us he was tempted in all things, just like you and I. See, the scriptures have to make him a man. Otherwise, it doesn't matter when he's on the cross. The pain wouldn't have been that much if it was just God. How can you hurt God? Can God bleed? Can God have water? But no, Jesus was fully a man. That's why the cross means so much. Oh, I know that we say Jesus, Jesus, but don't run away from the pain of the cross. Don't run away from the feelings of humanity when you witness a man there bleeding.
Yes, hallelujah.
Jesus recognized he had to go to Jerusalem because his daddy had told him at the beginning of times, his son, you're going to have to go. And even now, since we've met Jesus in a manger in Bethlehem 33 years ago, it has all accumulated and come to this moment in time when he will come into Jerusalem. And you see what the text tells us as he was coming down the Mount of Olives. See, if you've ever been blessed to go to Israel, I know there are some who have. Amen. If you go down on that slope of the Mount of Olives, you will see a magnificent panoramic view of Jerusalem. Yeah. As you're coming down the Mount of Olives, you will see the whole city that is right in front of your faces. You will have the view of $1 million. You will have a view that people will pay so much for. Jesus, as he's coming down this hill, as he is entering into Jerusalem, as the people with the palms are yelling out, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." If you see all of these things taking place, this moment of joy, this moment of fulfillment, this moment of triumph, and all of a sudden there are those who try to take it away.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Oh, don't let your joy be founded in what other people say about you.
That's right.
Don't let your feelings of whether or not you're happy or sad dictate on what someone else is going to put in your space. Because there's some people who seek to manipulate you by wanting you to feel how they feel, whatever it is they want you to feel that way. See, I wasn't even going to preach about this today, but I got to admit something else to you. This was one of those weeks where I just had a whole bunch of sermons to get out of. See, I don't know if enough people take it serious enough, Tammy. I only have 52 of these. I can't waste any. See, there's no giveaway Sunday that just says, well, I can't give the people my best today. So there was one sermon on Tuesday, I was looking about soul food. And then there was another one that said the tools of the trade. But it came down to this one as I was preparing for those. The Lord said, talk about when I showed up in their midst. He was coming down the Mount of Olives. Jerusalem is in full view. There are those who say, Jesus, you need to tell those folks to be quiet. And Jesus says, it doesn't matter if they're quiet or not, because if they get quiet, the rocks are going to start crying out. But see, that's why I don't get concerned. I try not to fish for amen. You know, there's a lot of preachers and pastors, they be fishing for amen. Every other word they say, can you say amen? Talk to me. I can't do my best unless you say something. See, I put that aside a long time ago, Sister Diggs, because I realized that one of these Sundays, if y'all don't say anything, all of a sudden that piano's going to start talking. Everybody's going to say amen. As soon as somebody doesn't say anything, Brother Will, and let that box right there get to saying amen, every last one of y'all going to say amen. I'm not nervous about whether or not somebody else going to say something. The scripture says if they don't say something, something else will say something. Now, I like it when you say something. moment of fulfillment, the moment of prophecy. You see in verse 41 that as he got to Jerusalem, he started crying. He wept. And I believe what we see there in the text, my brothers and sisters, is that we are witness to Jesus' heart for the city. We see his heart for the city. There are so many of us that are disconnected from the ills of what happens in our midst. And we say to ourselves, if it doesn't happen to me, then it doesn't really matter. It's not that impactful in my life. But it would that since God has met us, and God has come to visit us, and God has been with us, it would that we would have a heart for the city. In the year 2015, there were 280 murders in the city of Philadelphia. Up to this point, March the 16th in 2016, we've seen 54 murders in this city. The city of Philadelphia has the deepest poverty rate of any large city in the country. Right now, 186,000 persons, 60,000 of whom are children, are living in deep poverty. And what does that mean to be in deep poverty? That means if you are a family of four, you make less than $12,000 in which to live. And there are many of us who have been, we are safe. We have carpet and it's nice and we have windows and the grass is cut and we have cars and we have clothes and we have food and there's coffee and there's a wonderful place to come. But my brothers and sisters, God is letting us know, and we see a picture of Jesus right now, is that he's asking us, do we have a heart for the city? See, because when you have a heart for the city, that means that we are invested in the city. Now you say, Pastor, well, what can I do? What can I do about the situation? You work where the Lord has planted you to work. See, one of the things that has been detrimental to our communities in this city and all across is that we have lost the understanding of community. What does it mean? If you see a child on the block and you say it'd be nice if their parent brought them to church, how is it that we haven't gone to ask whether or not we can take the child? There was a time, and I don't know this because my parents were bringing me, but there was a time when if you were in the neighborhood and you couldn't get there, somebody who was on their way would take you. Now, we've become a little gun-shy because of some of the things that we've witnessed in our communities, but I tell you, there's a call of God on our lives that says, will you have a heart for the city? Right. And you can't say, well, I need the city to get right before I have a heart for it. I can't. The city has to know the songs of Zion before they can get in my car. I only listen to 103.9. Right? It can't be a situation that says they have to be all that I want them to be before they come, because if that was the case, where would you and I be? Yeah. If we had to be at a certain space before God would do what God said he would do. Yeah. How would it work? How would the story of Calvary work, Jameer, if all of a sudden Jesus said, you first have to do this before I go on the cross? Yeah. It wouldn't have worked, but Jesus said, I came for the sinner. I came for those that are outside, that they might have life and have it more abundantly. We see Jesus with a heart for the city because he's crying over the city. How we become callous to the situations that we see day to day. Amen. That this is just the way it is. That this is just the way it's going to be. And then we chalk it up. And we say to ourselves, well, you know, Jesus said, the scripture said, in the last days. But the question I have for us, are we going to exercise paralysis simply because we are in the last day? Amen. Yes, hallelujah. Are we going to write it off to say no one else can come into the kingdom of God? Or are we going to roll up our sleeves and get right smack dab in the middle and say, I come to you in the name of the Lord?
Yes, hallelujah.
See, we are called to be bold in this time in which we live.
Yes, yes.
See, if you had, I was talking to someone who shall remain nameless, and they were telling me about why they're not scared of folks and things in the day and time. They said, well, I have a gun, and my gun has some bullets, and I know how to use it, and the Lord has blessed me. Well, I know guns, and I understand the gun debate, and I understand that folks use guns, and I understand that people have them. But let me tell you a little secret. Sister Brittany and Sister Deborah, let me tell you a secret, Deacon James. We have something that's far greater than a gun with some bullets. You see, we got something that's far greater. I told myself this morning I was going to leave that jacket on. But it just doesn't work, praise God. There are some folks that say, well, I have this, and that means that I'm the one in charge. I'm the Mr. Big Stuff. I can do all these different things. But Sister Jerry, we have something greater than that, and that is the name of Jesus. Because the scriptures say, Brother Shaka, that in the name of Jesus, everything must bow. Things above the earth and on the earth and under the earth. If you find yourself in a jam sometimes, don't say those four-letter words. Just say Jesus. And you'll see, say Jesus long enough, Sister Jolene, and some things start to change.
Yes,
you say Jesus long enough, you start feeling a little power, and all of a sudden, like Jeremiah said, it starts whirling on the inside when you say the name of Jesus.
Yes.
The day God visited you, when he came to Jerusalem, he had a heart for the city because he began to cry over the city. And he lets them know in verse 42, if you had known in this day, even you, the things which make for peace, but now they have been hidden from your eyes. For you see, he understood the consequences of them not believing. He understood that the day would come in 70 AD when Jerusalem would be destroyed. He understood what was going to take place in the city, that the walls would come down, the people would scatter, the children would not have what they need. He understood the consequences of them not receiving Jesus. He understood that if you don't get it now, that there's destruction coming your way. And I understand the reality of the text that lets us know that the same is headed for us. There is destruction, there is pain, there is heartache, and there is tears if we do not point the people to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I'm not talking about pointing folks to the different things that we think really matter. I'm talking about pointing folks to the only person who can change the situation from the bottom to the top, and his name is Jesus. I don't know anyone else that when you touch the hem of his garment, your condition of blood will dry up. I don't know anybody else that when he walks by you and he puts his hand on you, that you thought you were dead, but now you get up. I don't know anybody else, Sister Mel, that can go to the tomb and say, Lazarus, come forth, and he really shows up. His name is Jesus. I don't know anybody else that all of a sudden can start walking on water and not falling down. His name is Jesus. I don't know anybody else who goes to a party and when the liquor runs out, he says, make some more and keep the party going. His name is Jesus. Now for the sake of the change in your mind, there's some of y'all, consequences too strong for people not to receive Jesus. Well, as the text keeps moving, friends, and we see as he had been crying, and he sees that he's calling us with this heart for the city, this heart for the people, this heart for the conditions that are around. Before I move on, let me share this. See, this is, I told the folks on Wednesday night, and I'll tell you this morning, that is why we should have an effervescent, a strong pride in the name of our local church.
Yeah.
See, it's important that we understand this. See, when folks say, well, what church do you go to? You say it strong, and you say it loud, and you don't move your feet and start looking around. You say exactly what it is.
Amen.
The Christian church in Philadelphia.
Amen.
See, the thing is, what does that mean? That means that we are Christians. We have confessed with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believed in our hearts that God had raised him from the dead, and therefore we are saved. When we've had the opportunity, We've been baptized in water, and we have been baptized by the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit now dwells within. But recognize, we are the Christian church, and we are in Philadelphia.
Amen.
We're not running.
Amen.
We're not hiding.
Amen.
We're not saying that we're of Philadelphia, but we are saying that we are smack dab in the middle of Philadelphia. So that means that we have to say something about the conditions of Philadelphia. We have to say something about the inequities in Philadelphia. We have to say something about the reality of Philadelphia, the systematic evil in Philadelphia. We are calling, if we don't say anything, then who is going to say something? But I said it before and I'll say it again. Christians are quiet about things we ain't got no business being quiet about. Because we talk a lot about stuff that doesn't really matter. Don't abbreviate it. Don't try to say it quick. You let them know who exactly we are and who we profess to be. That we are Christians. And we're proud of it on Monday. Proud of it on Tuesday. Proud of it on Wednesday. Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Showed up on Sunday. I'm a Christian. And I'm in Philadelphia.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Broke my glasses preaching on. The next thing we see as the text moves on is that he says to them in verse 44, you did not recognize the time of your visitation, the time when I came to be with you. For you see, when we are cognizant of Jesus being in our midst, we are cognizant of the time we've met him, and even still, everyone close their eyes for a minute. I want you to think real hard. When did you first meet Jesus? I'm not talking about when did someone tell you to come to church. I'm not telling you when your mama told you to walk up front. I'm talking about you. The time when you were in the space and Jesus was real to you. Whatever the condition was. And when Jesus was real, open your eyes for a second. See, it's different for each one of us. It could have been on the mourner's bench sometime in the middle of a revival. It could have been when we found ourselves in the midst of a bar, found ourselves in no hope and had to come to the last place that offered hope. It could have been something else. But when did you meet Jesus? And when you met Jesus and it became real to you on the inside, some things had to change.
Yes.
See, the same thing here. Jesus tells them, he says, listen, you didn't recognize the day of your visitation when I was here, so I know the destruction that is coming your way. But since I am here, some things have to change, namely this idea of usury. Usury, what does that mean? That is when you charge exorbitant rates on interest to people that need the loan. That's the idea. When I think about Christians, we talking about certain things, but no one's talking about the predatory payday loans. Everyone wants to talk about stuff that, you know, that goes over well, but no one wants to talk about charging folks that don't have the money 30 and 40 and 50% on money that they need to feed the children. And Jesus is very clear on the text that you see right now. Look at what he says when he gets to the temple, Sister Willamette. He starts wrecking shop. He starts tossing tables and telling folks that you have made my father's house of prayer a den of thieves. What was the situation? It was twofold. Everyone listening real good. First things first. Well, the first thing is every Jewish male had to pay the temple tax. And the temple tax was 1.5 shekels. And in order to get the 1.5 shekel, oftentimes if you came from a various country, you had to change your money. So first things first, if I went to someone and they changed out my currency to the current currency to get my 1.5 shekels, they charged me interest on the first exchange. But second, if I didn't have exact change and I gave them a 20 and they had to give me some change back, I got charged twice of the interest. That's one. So Jesus is looking at the situation. I know that my brothers that are coming to the temple have to pay the temple tax, but you are taking advantage of them because the temple tax is worth 2 weeks of work to a working man. And you see the situation, taking advantage. Part two of the situation. Every feast had an opportunity to go and sacrifice. So you know, and I shared that Wednesday night, you know that if I go to the ball game, you ever notice if you go down South Philly and you go into a game, you can buy the same Coca-Cola for $1.50 at the CVS right there. When when you get inside, it costs you $9. It's the same idea. The same idea is here. I had to come to the temple to sacrifice the dove. But you know what? If I bought my dove back at home because I got a better price, guess what the people did at the temple? They set up inspectors of the sacrifice. So then I could look at your sacrifice and say, oh, you can't use this one. It has a spot or it has a blemish. So therefore, you have to buy my dove. And guess what? The same one that I got for a dollar back at home cost me $20 in Jerusalem. So when Jesus shows up, he says, enough is enough. I cannot allow you to take advantage of my people. You have made my Father's house into a den of thieves. See, because when God shows up in our space, we are called to change some things about our living and how we speak about the conditions of the world. And we see it even now. We see it even now, people praying on the poor, praying on those that have the least amount to give. You see it even in churches. Sometimes you'll go to churches and every other thing on the program is taking offering. They say, well, I need an offering for this, and I need an offering for that, and you got to write a check for this, and can I get 10 more people with $1,200 to bless you, and God's going to bless you back? Enough is enough. We're taking advantage of the people. I am over the pastor having an S500 and the folks on set. I can't handle it. That's why you can't say nothing to me. I got a 2008 Toyota Corolla. It's right in the spot. I fixed the dent because I know that y'all was getting mad at me. I had this dent on the car. They didn't want the pastor to have the dent. But I used to tell my mother when she used to try, Al, you should fix the dent. This is what I told her. I said, Mom, it doesn't affect one bit how the car rides. And guess what? Is paid for. I don't owe any payments on anything. So let me just say this, and I love you, I really do. I love you. I love Pastor Dave, they ate me. Amen. But if you ever want me to get another car, you show up with the check and I'll go buy it with you. Amen. Jesus, the day God visited you, he comes and he has a heart for the sinner. He comes and says, enough is enough. I cannot allow you to take advantage of my people. The last thing that we see here on this moment, this momentous occasion of the palms of entering into Jerusalem, is that even though he was sad for a moment, even though he had the wreck shop in the temple, he still kept doing what God had sent him to do. Amen. He still kept doing what God had sent him to do. My brothers and sisters, I can't stress it enough that the time is drawing nigh that we have to work. The day is going to come when no man can work, so we must work while it is yet still day. We cannot be turned aside by those who would seek to say, well, no, Pastor, we can't do that today. We don't have time to play games with church. We don't have time to act like this is just a gathering of people. No, we are called to be disciples of Christ. We are called to be followers of the Most High. We are called to speak with conviction and with boldness. We are called to let our actions match up with our words. We are called to make a difference in this world in which we live. We can't turn back. Amen. Amen. Jesus knew he was going to be crucified. He knew that the folks were coming after him. But look at what the text said in verse 47. And if you don't have your Bible, please, I want everyone to see. In verse 47 of Luke 19, and he was teaching daily in the temple. But the chief priests and the scribes and the leading men among the people were trying to destroy him. And they could not find anything that they might do, for all the people were hanging on to every word he said. They knew that he was going to be arrested. He knew that they were looking for him. We've known for a while now that Judas was going to be the one to betray him. we've known for a while now that as his last supper comes, that he is going to be taken up to Golgotha Hill. We've known for a while now that he's going to have to carry a cross. We've known for a while now the prophecy that says the water and blood shall come out of his side. We've known for a while now that they have it in for him, but we also know that Jesus says, so what? Oh, hallelujah. I don't know if you got it. You might have missed it. There might be someone that be trying to take advantage of you and try to have your downfall and say negative things about you. But even in that space, I want you to say, so what? You can talk about me. Say it with me. So what?
So what?
You can say every manner of evil against me, but we say,
so what?
You can try to double hand me and double cross me. You can try to do me in. You can try to do all these negative things, but all I say is,
so what?
Because you don't know what I know, and I know that God is with me, and if God is with me, you can stand against me. Help somebody today.
Yes.
You know, one of the greatest difficulties of the human condition, get me here, not just us, the human condition, there are so many people that would be better off if they just let go of what people thought about it.
Yes.
They become victims of what someone else thinks about you. Never mind what goes on in my house and what you think I ought to do, or what I should drive, or what I should wear. I am trying to please God. I'm not worried if I have the latest thing, and I don't even know how to work the stuff there. Folks look at me and they say, I know they do. My wife, she says it all as we go out. She says, Lord, have mercy, help my husband. But it doesn't bother me one bit, Brother Brian. They say, well, have you got this? I say, no. Do you know how to work this? No. Have you been here? No. And then they say, well, I don't know if you on the in crowd. I'm always in the in crowd because I'm always with Jesus. Now, some people might say that is a braggadocious. Is that the word? That's braggadocious. She's the lawyer, amen, and she blessed us. She getting married, y'all. So all the men that missed out on the gym, what do we say? So what? The day God visited you, what did it do to us? How did it change us? What does it call us to? The day that God visited you. I still remember it. And as Sister Belinda comes, I'll share my testimony. See, I never get tired of sharing my testimony. Why? Because it changed my life.
Amen.
There's two instances that I remember clear as day. I was about 5 years old. I was sitting at the church at 13, 15, and I was hanging out with some of my friends. It's just a good thing. You got friends at church.
Amen.
See, that's half the reason we ought to bring our kids to church. They need some friends at church.
Amen.
We always want to make friends with everybody else, but make friends at the church. Because see, after a while, you turn into grown-ups at the church.
Amen.
And then you still got friends at the church.
Amen.
Well, I still remember I was sitting towards the back and the preacher was preaching and got to speaking about hell and I got nervous. I was sitting in my seat and I was trying to figure out this idea of hell, and then I was listening real hard at that point because I had to figure out how to miss it. See, I was hopeful that the preacher wasn't just going to leave me on a limb there and just say hell. I was holding out hope, Sabrina, that they were going to tell me how to get out of hell. Well, all of a sudden the preacher said, well, you can miss hell, and my ears perked up. He said, just receive Jesus. So I got up. No delay. I have to miss it. I got to get with Jesus. Now, you might laugh at that, but you know how many folks are on their way to hell?
Amen.
See, the pastor problem is nobody's talking about it.
Amen.
Everybody's letting it seem like it's all right.
Amen.
No. It's a hell to miss and a heaven to go to.
Yes.
And you best make sure you take care of that business quick, fast, and in a hurry.
Yes.
Well, that's one. Two, though, I was living in Ohio, and I'll tell you this, and I think I told you before, but this will bless someone. I was living in Ohio, trying to understand the rest of my life. I was trying to make it as this football player, right? And trying to make some money. And I wasn't driving a Corolla at the time. I had a big old truck, amen. But I smartened up. They used too much gas. And I was on my knees, and I was trying to understand, and I got to crying, and I didn't know what to do, and the Lord said, I'm calling you to a work. And Brother Rusty, my first response, I said, you got to have some people better than me. See, because when you know where you are or what you've engaged in or where you've been, the first thing that comes is this ethic or this idea of condemnation. This idea that says you're not good enough. This idea that says you can't do it. This idea that says the folks won't listen to you. But as I was in this back and forth exchange with God, see, don't be scared to talk to him. You know what happened? What happened was, he said, I've known who you were before you were you. I knew where you were going to go before you went. I knew what you're going to say before you said it. And if I've called you to the work, I'll take care of the rest. I just need you to say yes. It was at that moment I said yes. I said, all right, I don't understand all that's taking place. But I said I'd go. And little did I know the journeys that we would be on after a while. But I tell you all that to say, when Jesus becomes real to me, he was no longer just a little boy trying to miss out on hell. It was this call of Almighty God saying that we can be better than we've ever thought we could be. That we could be greater than we've ever thought we could be. That we could actually change some people and change the situations because Jesus is there. Tears come to my eyes right now, not because I'm sad. But because when you know what mercy is, and you know what mercy feels like in your own life, it changes some things. It changes how you view other folks and even how you view yourself. My brothers and my sisters, if you never received Jesus, I invite you to come. I invite you to come not so that we can build a kingdom on 8044 Staten Avenue, but so that we can know what it is to have fellowship with Jesus Christ. If you've never received Jesus, I invite you to come. Now let me be very clear. If you've never confessed with your mouth and believed with your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, I implore you, not as the pastor, but as your brother, let's do it right now. Second, if you want a good church home, it's a good place to be. With good folks, I invite you to come. Now you may be saying to yourself, I don't know if I'm ready. I don't know if I can do all that you're asking of me, Pastor, but I invite you to come. I invite you to come. If you want someone to pray with you, I invite you to come. Let us stand and let us sing together.